Thank you, Allison. What a lovely introduction. And thank you all for coming out here. Everyone find a parking spot, I hope. I don't know where you park here. So I'm going to be speaking to you in the next 45 minutes, because I've timed myself, about memory, about your memory. I'm going to be wearing a number of hats. I'm a neurologist, and I work in the memory clinic at Baycrest, and I see patients with memory loss who are worried about their memory or have dementia. We treat them, and I'm involved in research, as you heard about, to try and find new treatments, new ways to diagnose, and new ways to prevent Alzheimer's disease and dementia. So these are the things we're going to be talking about. And afterwards, there's going to be a panel discussion, and there's going to be time for questions, and I hope you'll stay with us. These are people who support me, and I do receive some support from pharma companies developing medications, but I'm not really talking about their medications. So what is it that we want? You know, I work with older people as a geriatric neurologist, and people say, well, what do you want? What's the goal here? And that's right, Ernest Hall. I always forget his name. This is Ernest Hall. This is from the Montreal Gazette. And this is he's an example of what we call successful aging. He's 99, and he's retired. And what he does, he's got 5 kids and a bunch of grandchildren. Every day, he goes to a different one of his children's homes. He goes and drives over. He does the shopping, and he's a great cook. He goes to their home. He prepares a 3-course meal. So when they come home from work and home from school, the kids come home from school, and his daughter-in-law and the son come home from work, and he's prepared this fabulous dinner, and they all sit and eat together, and then the kids help do the dishes, and he sits with them and helps them with their homework, and they have a wonderful time. And then the next day he goes to another one of his kids and does the same thing. So each day he rotates looking after his children, and you know, he is stimulating, he enjoys cooking, has a great time, and he's part of the family. He's contributing to them and part of their lives, part of their daily life, and everyone in the family looks forward to, oh, is grandpa coming tomorrow? Great, we'll finally eat something good. So this is what we want. You know, people don't live forever, but during our lives, and our lives are getting longer, we want people to remain physically functional and cognitively thinking. Their thinking has to remain functional, and they have to remain social, and they have to remain involved. And this is the goal. We want everyone to live a life such as Mr. Hall. So how good is your memory? Let's start with a little memory test. On the count of three, we're going to say these 3 words aloud. Everyone ready? Go. Ball, house, daisy. Now you all have to remember them until you see them again. So you got to recall those 3 words. That's one way to test memory. Here's another way. Later on in the talk, you'll see a picture of a camel. When you see the camel, raise both your arms. So this is called meta memory. This is another kind of memory. You've got to hold this in memory and remember that I've told you to raise your arms when you see the camel. That's all you have to do. Okay, so what happens with aging? Well, for a small proportion of the population, memory stays exactly the way it was when they were 20 years old. And we call these the supernormals. They have no decline their whole life in their memory. And if you're like that, you're very lucky and you're in the minority. For most people, there are normal changes, what we call normal changes in memory. What are these normal changes? Well, people have trouble remembering new names, not names of people in your family, but the names of someone you might have met a year ago, you haven't seen them for a year, you run into them on the street, and you think, what was that man's name? And you go home and stay up all night trying to remember the name, and maybe it comes, maybe it doesn't. Trouble remembering lists of words when people over 60 go to the shopping at Loblaws. You know, the wife will say, okay, get these 10 things, and they get to Loblaws, and they say, okay, I can remember 3 of them. What were the other 7 things I'm supposed to remember? And spatial loss of spatial memory. I used to work in a hospital where my office looked out on the parking lot, and you'd see the young doctors come out at the end of the day. They'd go straight to their car and get in and drive away. You'd see the older doctors come out, and they'd wander up and down the aisles looking for their car. So these are normal changes. About 12% of people over age 65 have more than what we consider normal. They complain of their memory. They say, my memory isn't as good as it used to be. And when we do tests, we say, you know, you're below the norms, what we expect for someone your age and education. We call this mild cognitive impairment. This is a very common term now. MCI, mild cognitive impairment. That means their performance on memory tests is actually worse and worse than it was before. And about 8% of people over the age 65 have what we call dementia. So together, 8% plus 12%, that's 20%, one person in five among our population over 65 have significant memory problems. I guess the good news is that means four out of five do not. So when people have dementia, that 8% of the population, what is causing it in this diagram? This is a Venn diagram, and I'm sorry the writing's a little small. About half of those people have what we call Alzheimer's disease, and another 10% have problems with blood flow, what we call vascular dementia, and then this big group have an overlap. They have both Alzheimer's disease and vascular changes with small strokes in the brain. And then there's some other smaller causes of dementia that we won't really talk about. So dementia is not one thing, it's a set of illnesses of the brain, what we call neurodegenerative illnesses. And we've sort of moved in the past 50 years from a time when we used to consider that most cases of dementia were due to problems with blood flow, the so-called vascular dementia, and now we think most cases are due to what we call Alzheimer's disease, where we see something different in the brain, which is not strokes. Why is dementia a concern? Well, it's good news and bad news. The good news is the population is getting older. People are living longer. In 2050, we will, in Canada, join one of the group of countries with more than 30% of the population over age 60. So we're going to be, you know, the dark blue are the countries with a lot of old people, and we're among that group. So that means people are living longer. But it also means the number of people with dementia will increase. In 2011, it was about three quarters of a million people. Sorry. By 2031, it'll double. So the number of people with dementia will increase because the greatest risk for dementia is age. As the population ages, there'll be more people with dementia. And concomitant with that, the cost of dementia to the country is going to go up by a factor of 10. It's going to become a huge burden on provinces and on the federal government. And of course, because Dr. Einstein, our chair in women's brain aging, is there, it's important to realize that many more of the people affected are women than men. About 72% of people with dementia are women, so it's very much a woman's issue. So if you look at the brain of people with Alzheimer's disease, this is a normal brain. This is someone with Alzheimer's. A shrinkage of the brain, you can look in the brain and see it is not normal. And if you look inside the brain, you might see different changes. These are plaques, which we see called senile plaques with amyloid, which we see in Alzheimer's disease. There are other changes, Lewy bodies, which are seen in certain kinds of dementia. Strokes can be seen, and it's particular changes of a disease called frontotemporal dementia. But in fact, what we usually see is a combination of more than one kind of dementia. Now, when people say, "What is dementia?" I thought I had a slide saying this, but dementia is impairment in your thinking, impairment in your memory, plus impairment in other kinds of thinking, which is significant. It's a decline from where you were before, and it's sufficiently severe that it interferes with your day-to-day functioning. So it's a clinical definition. It's not a definition based on a scan or a blood test. It's, you go to the doctor and they do the memory tests and find the significant impairment, and you talk about how much it impairs your day-to-day functioning, and that's how you attach the diagnosis of dementia. So it's a bit rough, as clinical diagnoses are. Alzheimer's disease, as I mentioned, is the leading cause of dementia, and the presentation is variable. The most common change is memory, And the most common complaint that the husbands and wives will say, well, my wife is repeating questions. I tell her something she doesn't remember a few minutes later. She's misplacing things. She can't bring, comes in from the garage, puts things down, she can't find them. And she goes out to do errands, she can't remember what she's gone out to do. So these memory problems. But there are other changes as well. There can be problems with language, trouble finding words, a change in judgment and ability to plan things, and other things which are not so much cognitive, but emotional and personality. So people can have personality changes. They can become suspicious. They can become very apathetic and withdrawn, a change from where they were before. And emotionally, they can often develop depression and anxiety in someone who wasn't depressed when they were younger. So these are the things which should lead you to worry about someone having dementia. These are the earliest signs. So someone has dementia, they go to the doctor, they're diagnosed with dementia such as Alzheimer's disease. What is the doctor going to do? Well, there are a number of things that will be done and should be done. There should be an assessment of who's looking after the person with dementia, who's the caregiver, and what support is available and what is needed to help the caregiver. So there are actually two patients who come in. There's the person with dementia and there's the person looking after them. Is there a safety issue in the home? You know, we have older people who smoke and will put the cigarette down and forget they've put the cigarette down and start fire. So there you have to assess, is the person safe in the kitchen and in the home? What about driving? Dementia leads to increased accidents. And unfortunately, when someone reaches a certain point of dementia, they should not be driving. What about day-to-day? Is the person just sitting in a chair watching television? Are they getting out, getting stimulation? What about their diet? Are they eating enough? People forget to eat, and we see them and say, you've lost 20 pounds, and they say, I forget to eat. I don't eat lunch. I forget. Medications and pills are important. If you have memory loss, you might take a heart pill two or three times by mistake, and you can actually drop your blood pressure and get seriously ill. We have to treat what we call comorbidities, other accompanying illnesses that make the dementia worse, such as heart disease or lung disease. And finally, that we have to do two important things. We talk to patients and their families. The family must be involved. We talk about the future because dementias get worse. Alzheimer's disease gets worse. You have to have the discussion. What will happen in the family when the person who's affected gets worse? Finally, we have some medications. In Ontario, it's mainly the pill donepezil or Aricept, which help the symptoms. We talk about if you're lucky, it rolls the clock back 6 months. It's not a magic pill, doesn't last forever, and certainly doesn't stop the disease. And this is the sort of basket of things we can offer patients once diagnosed with dementia, but there's no real treatment to stop or to slow Alzheimer's disease after it's been diagnosed. So that's the bad news. From the research point of view, we still do not know what causes Alzheimer's disease. We see things in the brain. We're not sure what is the cause, what is the effect, is it a combination of things? So without knowing the cause, it's been very hard to find the molecule to stop the disease. So that's where we are. We also don't know, is Alzheimer's disease, AD means Alzheimer's disease, is it one thing or is it a group of illnesses? We don't know why some people get it earlier. There are some genes that seem to be associated with getting it earlier, but we see people come in even in their 50s. About 15% of our patients have onset before age 60. Often we don't know why. We don't know how to prevent it coming on. We don't know how to delay or stop it. So how are we going to make progress? Well, research is the only way. And I'm going to, we need two things. We need people to participate in research, and you know, in material outside, you heard about can sign up to get memory testing, and you can sign up to volunteer for research. That's very important. We also need public support because you know when it's an election is coming, when someone comes to your door to ask you what you want in the government, you can say, you know, are you increasing public support and financial support for research on Alzheimer's disease, because Canada is lagging way behind. I'll say one slide about frailty. many older people get frail. When you see them, they're losing weight, they're slower, they're having trouble walking, they're tired, and they look frail. And many people with frailty also develop dementia, so there's an overlap. And we think that becoming frail is a great risk factor for developing dementia. Now, can we stop people becoming frail? Well, we believe with exercise, nutritional support, and good food, we can prevent frailty to some degree. So if you know an older person and you see, boy, she's looking thin, you know, she's not eating, the best thing you could do is go over and eat with them and bring food, make them eat, and encourage them to work on their nutrition and their exercise. We think it's important. So sobering clinical points again, we don't know the cause of Alzheimer's disease, Lewy body disease, frontotemporal dementia. There's been no new Alzheimer's treatment in the past 15 years. And again, this is points to our failure in understanding the disease. And we don't have any curative or disease-modifying therapy for any of these neurodegenerative diseases. In fact, Alzheimer's disease is the only major cause of death without any disease-modifying therapy. So this is pretty bleak, and this is sort of the low point in the lecture. I'm giving sort of the reality, and it's sobering, it's bad news. So I'm based at Baycrest, and a little point, what are we doing? Well, we're doing a number of things. We're clinically looking after our patients, many of whom have dementia or mild memory loss. We're looking after our community. We're assessing them, diagnosing them, and looking after them as best we can using the best medicine available. We're involved in teaching, training health professionals for the future about dementia, and research. The main focus of research at Baycrest is brain structure, aging, memory, and brain health. So we're looking for better ways to diagnose, better treatments, better care, and a cure. Finally, Baycrest believes that we have to get involved in policy. And in fact, as Alison Sekular mentioned, there's a ministerial committee to help advise the Minister of Health in developing a national strategy, and the committee is chaired by Dr. Bill Reichman, the CEO of Baycrest. So we're doing our best to get involved at a policy level to try and make things better. Well, I don't think I'm going to say anything about my own research because of time. Well, I'll say one or two things. So I'm involved in doing a lot of studies in brain stimulation with electricity, which seems to help some patients with Alzheimer's disease, some volunteers. So excited about that. And Allison talked about I'll come back to the MoCA in a minute. We're looking on hearing loss as a modifiable factor because, you know, as I'll show you in a minute, hearing loss is something we can correct. A lot of people who are older have impaired hearing. They don't get diagnosed. They don't get treated with hearing aids. That probably makes their dementia worse. So that's the other thing. When you have an older person in your family, and they're no longer hearing you. They're saying, what? Or they're not hearing you. Get them tested and get them hearing aids, and that can improve the memory. So that's my advertisement about signing up to participate, and we'll come back to volunteering in a minute. You know, and there are 24 other Rotman Research Institute scientists carrying out a host of projects, and we're very interested whether you have memory loss or whether your memory is good. So volunteering helps. The MoCA I was referred to, we're very proud of. This is a test used in memory. This is what it looks like. Okay, you all did well. Yeah, so it's about a 10-minute test that's used around the world for telling if a person has normal memory or has some memory impairment. Okay, so is all memory loss Alzheimer's disease? Well, no. As I mentioned, people who are normal can have problems recalling names and the spatial memory in the parking lot. If someone's memory is worse than others, what we call mild cognitive impairment, there are multiple reasons. Sometimes they've always had a bad memory, and in fact, they haven't gotten worse. They just have a terrible memory, and people are like that their whole life. Some people are depressed or anxious. You know, when you're worried and anxious and someone tells you something, the odds are you're not going to remember it the next day. And if you remember, I remember back in university, the night before a big exam, there'd be people in the library studying. They'd be so anxious. They'd study. They wouldn't remember a thing they were studying. They were so worried. If you're taking sedatives or many medications or alcohol, that can impair your memory. medical illnesses of the heart or the blood, vascular problems, diabetes, sleep apnea. Anyone who has obstructive sleep apnea, snores a lot and has blockage in their breathing, they, during the day, they're sleepy and their memory is bad. And this is something that can be treated, very important. Other neurologic conditions, and what we're most concerned about, what we call prodromal Alzheimer's disease. In other words, the mild memory loss is the beginning of something worse. It's the beginning of a dementing disorder. So why is this important? Well, we think that Alzheimer's disease, well, we know it's a chronic disease. What does that mean? It means that if here's the point in time when someone comes to memory clinic and we say you have Alzheimer's disease, you have dementia, it doesn't mean the illness started a week before or a month before. It actually probably started about 15 years before, and it's been coming on gradually in the brain, and we can now do tests of the brain and find evidence of changes in the brain, changes in brain structure, changes in brain function, which precede the, by many years, the time when they're diagnosed, and can even precede when they start to complain of memory loss itself. So this is what we call a prodrome. We talk about this sort of continuum of normal cognition to mild cognitive impairment to dementia. And basically, this is underlying that in the mild cognitive impairment condition, there are two ways you're going to go. Some people are not going to progress to dementia. For example, if there's a problem with sleep apnea or it was anxiety, other people will progress to dementia if they're followed over a few years. So can we do anything at this point to prevent people getting worse? This is the question. So when should you be worried about your memory loss, excuse me, or the memory problems of someone else you know? Well, there are some red flags. If they're forgetting important things, forgetting plans and appointments, forgetting significant conversations, forgetting the month, forgetting the year, forgetting the names of close family members, not someone they haven't seen in a year, but someone that they should know, grandchildren's names. And if they're getting lost in familiar places, these are things that should trigger a visit to the doctor to get the problem assessed. Because there are also treatable causes of dementia, rarely, but not insignificantly. We find a removable brain tumor or a low B12 or a thyroid problem. So you can't always assume that dementia means untreatable Alzheimer's disease. We're trying to develop ways to look at people with mild cognitive impairment and predict who's going to go on to dementia, and there are various methods. This is a dementia risk score, which, well, the biggest risk is age, and this is the problem you get. If you're over age 53, you automatically get 4 points, and so the biggest risk is age. Other risks are lower education, higher blood pressure, if you're obese, if you have a higher cholesterol, if you're inactive. There are other ways we can try to find early indicators that you're likely to go on to dementia. We can look at the brain structure, as I said. Here's a normal half of the brain, and look at particularly at this area, the hippocampus, which is involved in memory. This is the comparison brain of someone with Alzheimer's disease, and here the hippocampus is shrunk. It looks like a shrunken almond, and that's suggestive of this person has the onset of Alzheimer's disease in its early stages. Well, we don't take the brain out, but you can do an MRI scan and you can get basically the same picture. So here's an MRI scan of an individual. Which person do you think has the most likely to go on to Alzheimer's? Well, this is the normal one. This is the person with the shrinkage. So this is the person who went on to Alzheimer's disease. We can look at other things. We can now look using PET scanning at certain proteins that are deposited in the brain, such as amyloid protein, which is not does not prove Alzheimer's disease, but someone who has mild memory loss and amyloid almost certainly is going to go on to Alzheimer's disease. So this is called an amyloid PET scan. And we've shown it superimposed on their MRI, their brain structure. And the amyloid shows up as yellow and red. And in this brain, you see almost nothing, right? The little tiny bits of red. So this person did not go on to Alzheimer's disease. Here I'm going to show you the amyloid scan of another person with mild memory loss. And this is what their scan looked like. A lot of red, a lot of yellow, a lot of amyloid being deposited. So this was about 10 years before he was diagnosed as having Alzheimer's dementia. So, you know, we can look for these things called biomarkers. They can define which individuals with mild cognitive impairment have this prodrome of Alzheimer's disease and are going to get worse. So we have a whole string of biomarkers available now, and they're available for research. But the problem is, if you go to your doctor and say, I want to have the amyloid PET scan, and I want to have a saliva test and spinal fluid and blood test, you'll be told, well, these aren't available for people in the community. These are just for research. And the reason is, it's not a bad reason. When you're doing medicine, you do a test because it's going to change your management. And right now, we don't have any medication or pill or drug or schedule to give you if you have amyloid in the brain. We don't have a strategy to get rid of it. So knowing you have amyloid in your brain is not going to change your management at the doctor's. We're involved in research protocols. We want to know these things. But practically speaking, when you go to your doctor, they're not going to suggest you get biomarkers done for a good reason. We don't have a new therapy. By the way, how good is your memory? What were those three words? Ready, go. Excellent. Well done. Ball house. Is that it? Ball house Daisy? I hope so. So what do we want? What we want is a way to have a magic bullet or flip a switch, get rid of the risk of Alzheimer's disease, one intervention to prevent or reverse it, but we don't have that. What we learn from molecular biology is that the brain is very complicated, synapses and brain cells are complicated, and Alzheimer's may be the end of a complex cascade. So it may take years or even decades to find the molecule that stops or reverses Alzheimer's disease. And there may be subtypes. It may be that one person's Alzheimer's needs one treatment, but another person requires a quite different treatment. So we've got a long way to go. Oh, this is one of my students tearing his hair out when he understands how complicated it is to understand a brain cell. So what's the alternative? Well, we can try to bring in non-toxic, easy to take, acceptable approaches to try and prevent Alzheimer's. And if we could only slow the progression, if we could delay the onset by 5 years, there'd be a 50% reduction in the prevalence, the number of people with Alzheimer's disease in the society. So this is a very feasible goal right now, to try and delay the onset of Alzheimer's disease, prevent Alzheimer's disease, and that will at least reduce the number of people affected by a great deal. How can we do this? Well, we look for risk factors, and we know a lot about risk factors. You know, this little cartoon, each risk factor is like a punch to your brain, making your brain more susceptible to Alzheimer's. And we have a list of risk factors that can be modified. And actually, I when you came in, if you didn't pick it up, you can get on the way out. I handed out the list of the 14 things that you can do to prevent Alzheimer's disease. So if you didn't pick it up, you don't have to scribble it down. It's out there on the table. So how much can we prevent dementia? Well, there risk factors all the way through from the time you're born. Some of them are genes, such as APOE4. You can't change your genes, but some are in early life, such as education, middle life, and late life. And we're going to talk about the things where you can intervene, change your life, and help prevent Alzheimer's disease. And there's been a calculation done that probably about 30% of Alzheimer's disease could be prevented if we attended to seven risk factors. So let's talk about what can be done. These are the seven risk factors for dementia that emerged from studies. You know, they're diabetes, high blood pressure, obesity, inactivity, depression, smoking, and low educational attainment. Well, hard to go back and get more education, so let's focus on the things we can do. So first, the list of 10 things that you can't really do much about. So first of all, genetics. You can't go back and choose your parents. You're stuck with your parents. You're stuck with your genetics. You're stuck with what you've inherited from your mother and father. You also can't change your age, and aging is a major risk factor, but we have to accept that. Certain personalities are more prone to developing dementia, but I just don't think you can snap your fingers and change your personality. Where you live, well, some people would change this, but there's evidence I'll show you in a minute that, that if you live within 100 meters of a highway, pollution from the highway is actually slightly raising your risk of getting dementia. So we're beginning to learn that things in the environment do have an impact. Head injuries. Well, nobody goes out looking for severe head injuries, but car accidents, concussions, those do increase your risk of getting Alzheimer's years later. And then things to build what we call cognitive reserve, the number of connections in your brain. I'll come back to those in a second. So yeah, this is the study, air pollution. If you're within 100 meters of a highway, you have a small, but it is there, increase in your risk of getting dementia. And this is the looking at TBI, that's traumatic brain injury like concussions, particularly if you have a severe or moderate brain injury where you're knocked out for a day, you have 3 or 4 times the risk of getting dementia. So avoid head injuries, and if you, it's too late to avoid your own head injuries, make sure all the kids you know are bicycling with a helmet and avoiding getting their heads hit. So brain and cognitive reserve, these are things that are good for the brain and help protect you from dementia. But again, many of these are hard to modify in your life. If I say, make more money, have a higher income, and have a higher socioeconomic level, that's pretty hard for someone to go out and do. But an infant diet, well, you know, none of us are babies, we can't do much about that. Complex work, more education, bilingualism. I suppose people could go out and learn another language. Most of you aren't going to go out tomorrow and learn another language. So these are things that are good for the brain, but hard to go back and change them. So these are the things you can modify. So this is, This is the key list, and this is on the handout outside. So there's a list of 14 things, and we're going to go through them in the next 5 minutes. So I'm going to go through them. First, treat your medical problems. Get checkups. Make sure your heart, your thyroid, your kidneys are all taken care of. And go to your doctor and get a checkup. Avoid sedatives and alcohol. If you use sleeping pills every night, stop. Find some other way to get to sleep. The best thing is exercise during the day. More and better sleep. This is sort of new. People who get less than 6 hours sleep have a higher risk of getting dementia. So I've myself added an hour to my sleep. I seem to enjoy it. It's nice to sleep an extra hour. So aim for 7 hours or 8 hours, because there's something magic about sleep. We now know that while you're asleep, the amyloid proteins, the toxins in your brain, are being cleared out of the brain. We didn't know this 10 years ago. Sleep is very important for your brain health. And this is just a diagram showing sleep fragmentation. That's how people who have bad sleeps have a higher incidence of Alzheimer's disease, and this has now been shown. Some of this work being done by our colleague Andrew Lim at Sunnybrook. Other things to do, this is very important, treating your vascular risk factors. We know that stroke and high blood pressure work synergistically with the bad proteins of Alzheimer's disease to produce dementia. So you want to have your high blood pressure treated. If you have any heart rhythm problems, they should be treated. Stop smoking. Smoking is bad for your heart. It's bad for your brain. And if your cholesterol is high, it should be treated as well. In fact, when we look at the modifiable risk factors, many of them are risk factors for stroke and dementia together. And one of those is obesity. We know that obesity is bad for your heart. We now know that it's bad for your brain as well. So exercise and losing weight and being active, and you've now got another reason to do it. If you didn't want to do it for your heart, do it for your brain. I said that stroke works synergistically. That means that, well, there's a very interesting study of nuns in Kentucky. Here's one of the nuns. And they were tested on their memory, and then when they died, their brains were examined. And when we looked at nuns who had changes of Alzheimer's disease in their brain after death, if they had no strokes, infarcts or strokes, if they had no strokes, only 57% of them had actual dementia with memory loss. If they had any strokes, that went up to even up to 93%. So the presence of even one or two strokes brought on the dementia, brought it out. And many people have small strokes and never know it, what we call subclinical strokes. So high blood pressure, smoking, cholesterol, all bad for your vasculature in your brain and can bring on these silent strokes that you may never be aware of. The good news is that this is Ontario data from Dr. Hachinsky in London, Ontario. This shows what's happened in the rate of strokes since the year 2002, that the number of strokes in Ontario is falling because people are stopping smoking and getting their blood pressure treated. And concomitantly, this is the rate of dementia, is also showing a very mild decline, probably as a result of treating to prevent strokes. So they go together. Next, avoid diabetes and pre-diabetes, what's been called the metabolic syndrome. And this goes along with obesity, and it changes the insulin. The insulin level in your blood goes up, and that affects the brain. It causes inflammation. It causes amyloid deposition. So diabetes leads to Alzheimer's disease. So if you have diabetes, get it controlled. If you're at risk of diabetes, have it assessed and treated. Next two, more things that you can do. Keep physically fit. How much you should be getting, everyone in this room should be getting 150 minutes a week of moderate exercise, aerobic exercise, walking, calisthenics. So 150 minutes, that's 2.5 hours spread over the week. And that's the same if you're 50, 60, or 70. And we know that if you take people who are couch potatoes and get them in a training program, you take about 2 years off their brain age. People's thinking and memory is just better. Next is what we call intellectual and cognitive stimulation. You need to be doing something to stimulate your brain. While you're all doing that, you're here tonight, and hopefully this is stimulating your brain. So do these things. Go to classes, read books, participate in book clubs. You've got to keep your brain, is in a sense like a muscle. You've got to keep using it. And these are a list of the good things that exercise does for your brain. I'm not going to go through the list. So we've gone through many of these risk factors and protective factors related to dementia. And let's see what I've left out. I mentioned earlier hearing loss. I don't see it on the list, but hearing loss, getting it treated. Oh yeah, I've got some more. Lifestyle issues, what we call social capital. Things that you can change in your life that will actually affect your risk of getting dementia. For example, stress. Now, we live in Toronto, none of us can avoid stress. But some people are living at such a high stress level their whole life, it does take a toll on the brain. We now know that people who have very high levels of stress in their 40s and 50s and 60s have a higher rate of getting dementia. So, you know, how do you affect that? I mean, that's almost a non-medical question, but it's something to think about. What is the stress in your life? Is it too much stress for you to handle? Depression. People who have depression have an increased rate of getting Alzheimer's disease. If you have depression, talk to your doctor and get it treated. Depression is treatable. And the last two are, I think, very important. Let's start with this. Social activity. You know, everyone should be in a book club. In fact, people should be in walking book clubs. A book club, you get together with people, you have intellectual stimulation, you drink coffee, you have friends, and a walking book club, you get up and walk while you're doing that. That's a perfect activity. But see your family, have a social network, think about who's in my social network. Do I see my friends or do I just stay in the house? People who are most social and have a greater network, it protects your brain. So more socially active, less dementia develops. Finally, and this is very difficult, there are studies showing that some people, when you do surveys, have a more of a purpose in life. And those people are less prone to developing dementia. You can't snap your fingers and get a purpose in life. Or can you? You know, in a talk yesterday, Dr. Nicole Anderson talked about volunteering. You know, people who, elderly people who go out and volunteer and bring joy to others and get involved in activities, report having, or may report having, increase in their purpose in life that can only be beneficial. So there are other things to think about. Living alone from the brain point of view, loneliness, living alone are bad, particularly if you're a man. Women seem to be more protected from these effects. I've talked about the social network and late life volunteering and cognitive health. And so this is our list of social capital things you can do. And this is Dr. Anderson's diagram on volunteering, that volunteering gives you physical activity and social activity and cognitive activity. And these are probably all beneficial for your brain. So is it possible to prevent dementia? We've talked about controlling blood pressure and other vascular risk factors, maintaining an active lifestyle, social integration. So this is quite a substantial list of things that you can do tomorrow to try and help yourself. Last two things, and then I'll call it quits. Hearing loss, I've talked about diet. It's now been shown that people's diets do have an effect on their brain. What we don't know is to what extent you can switch your diet at age 60 and still be beneficial versus being on a good diet your whole life. So what kind of diet are we talking about? Well, the classic one now is the Mediterranean diet, which is shown here. And this is a diet with very little red meat and very little sweets, very little sugar. Get rid of those things. You have poultry, have fish, there's a big fish there, and mainly have fruits and vegetables and grains. We call it a Mediterranean diet, but there's no pizza on here. There's not a lot of fatty foods. It's fruit and vegetable and grains, and okay, you can have half a glass of red wine a day that's got full of antioxidants. So a diet, you can vary it, and there's the MIND diet and the DASH diet, and they're slightly different, but you see the idea. And this actually goes along with the Canadian Food Guide recommendations. Carol Greenwood at Baycrest developed what's called a Brain Health Food Guide, and it's available online. And if you pick up the handout, we've got the website. You can download it. And it's a very clear guide, and it's something that everyone can follow. And this is the Canada's new food guide, also fits along with this healthy brain eating approach. Other dietary supplements that less important, but I put them up there, you know, flavonoids, that means blueberries and berries, green leafy vegetables, because that affects your homocysteine levels, a lot of olive oil in the Mediterranean diet. I talked about fish, poultry, pasta, and fruits and beans. So these are all things that are part of a healthy brain diet, and these I've already mentioned. So what's the problem with diet? Well, what this diagram shows is the big challenge. It's not so much which diet you choose to do, it's whether you stick to it. And no matter what diet people go on, only a percentage of them are still on it 9 months later. So, you know, the main thing is to find a diet that you can stick to that follows these rules of healthy eating, getting away from what we call a Western diet with high carbohydrates, high sugar, high red meat. So we've been talking about lifestyle and lifestyle, all the aspects that can lead to affecting your blood pressure, your diabetes, cholesterol, cardiovascular system, and ultimately leading to worsening of dementia. And the cognitive reserve we've talked about, and genes we haven't really spoken much about. There are other disease modification strategies that are unproven. I'm just listing them so people won't say they have to come up and ask a question. So all the trials of estrogen, anti-inflammatories, statins, ampicine, anti-amyloid therapy, ginkgo, none of these have been proven to prevent Alzheimer's disease. So what we're going to be doing, and I'm going to finish on this, in the coming years is trying to find, in addition to these strategies, combinations of pharmacological and non-pharmacological interventions that can work together to even more prevent Alzheimer's disease. We're looking for the best combination to to not just reduce by 30% the occurrence of Alzheimer's, but maybe by 50 or 60%. Because right now we don't know the dose, the timing, the combinations to use, and so we're going to be, I'm going to be jumping over things to make progress. We're working together, and what Allison Sekulor talked about is the CCNA. This is a big Canadian initiative where all the researchers are working together. And after the, we hope we're going to be getting our renewal and we'll be able to start our next 5 years based out of Baycrest. And this is a group where we've got teams focusing on prevention, treatment, and quality of life. We have a focus for the next 5 years. One of the focus foci is prevention strategies, and we're going to be developing a large set of prevention, a large cohort across the country where we're going to try out these different combinations of prevention strategies. So this is our initiation group in October, launching the, this prevention strategy across the country. We have under CCNA already studies where we're looking at people with memory concerns to look at computerized cognitive stimulation and dietary support and resistance training to see if we can come up with different strategies in people with very mild memory loss to prevent them getting worse. This is our prevention study. Because of time, I'm not going to go into details about it, but this is going to assemble a large cohort of people across the country and try different combinations of therapy for them to use. So, to finish, you know, a friend of mine showed this in a talk yesterday, that we all have the Lord of the Rings fantasy, that there's one ring that's going to give us magical powers to get rid of our problems in the future, as in the Lord of the Rings, and we're not going to find that. But at the present time, you can think about what might be helpful to you, what is unlikely to hurt, and what can you actually do to help your brain health? And these are the three things that every one of you has to think about from that list. So, you know, you can start exercising, you can improve your diet tomorrow, you can start getting better sleep, and you can become more socially active. And those among the other 14 things on the list will improve your ability to prevent dementia. Not completely, we're all at risk, but at least you're doing something active for your own benefit in the coming years. On that note, I want to thank you for your attention, and we're going to have a panel and take questions. Thank you very much.